To all the viewers, and a big note of thank you to Beyond the Law and Symbiosis Law School, the organizers of this webinar. As I said earlier, that it is really a pleasure to share this platform, maybe virtually and of course virtually, with the experts in the field from whom I have learned and understood the insight and nuances of gender and law, gender justice and mental health. In this session or the initial address, I would like to make some points as to the current situation as regards domestic violence, then the constitutional provisions relating to gender, then the what is meant by gender bias, the international convention treaties, a reference to them, the societal attitudes and what measures are already taken to contain this pandemic of domestic violence, and some measures which can still be taken over. Coming to the topic, as we are all aware, presently we are living in a difficult and critical time. At one and same time, we are facing several crises. Each one is unprecedented, whether it is COVID-19 or it is an economic slowdown. But both these crises are visible for everyone to see and experience. But then, both these crises have aggravated one more crisis, which may not be visible, which may not be experienced by everyone, but for the woman. And there may also be reluctance to acknowledge or accept its existence. But it is there, and this is the crisis of domestic violence, which is unprecedented again in every way. What has happened is that in the wake of COVID-19, and our lives and the world have come to a really halt. Everybody has been locked in homes for the purpose of stay home and stay safe. But this motto is not holding true for women. Though they may stay home and actually are confined to home, they are no more safe. Conversely, their stay at home is making them more vulnerable violence. As it is, women are never completely safe from violence. Their safety, already precarious, has become more precarious now. An invisible pandemic of domestic violence has invaded their lives. Fueled by the COVID-19, the ensuing lockdown and social distancing norms, this problem of domestic violence, as we all know, has increased gravely, and that is at global level also. In my opinion, the irony is that this is a time when we are marking the 25th anniversary of the landmark Beijing Declaration and the Platform for Action on Women's Rights and Gender Equality, which was in 1995. And it has acknowledged that domestic violence is undoubtedly a human rights issue and recommended the state parties to protect women against violence of any kind, especially that occurring within the family. As a matter of fact, domestic violence is not a new phenomena. It is a reality that existed throughout all the ages and through all the societies. Violence is a fact of a woman's life. Her condition, as they often say, is defined by the violence she faces, be that violence in her own home or at the workplace or anywhere else, be it from strangers or intimate partners, be it sexual or be it physical, domestic, emotional, or in any other way. It be it in the public or in the so-called private domain, be it by exclusion or by inclusion. But one fact is undisputed that it is widely prevalent in all the strata of society. In a way, violence perpetrated on women, whether it is sexual or domestic, is, as we all acknowledge, just the manifestation of gender bias. The unequal social and power structure existing in all societies between men and women. However, what is a matter of anguish for me personally is that this gender bias or unequal power structure exists in our society despite our constitutional commitment to equality. Our constitution is transformative, which is strongly committed to gender justice. It is a fundamental document of the Bill of Rights. The very preamble of the constitution reflects the ideals and aspirations of the people of India, and one of the primary ideal highlighted is the equality of status and equality of opportunity. It is irrespective of the age, class, gender, or any other thing. We know the fundamental rights enshrined in Article 14, 15, 16 are the soul of the constitution, and they assure the promise of gender equality. According to me, the most important article is 15.3 of the constitution, which gives a totally new dimension to the concept of equality. Recognizing and acknowledging the fact that for years together, women have been deprived from enjoying their basic human rights of equality and development. It is therefore an endeavor to bring women at par with men. Most importantly, in my view, it is an acknowledgement of inequality in the status of women vis-a-vis men, and recognizes the need for not only formal but substantive equality. As we all know, in addition to fundamental rights, we have got directive principles for state policy, like Article 39A, D, 39.2, directing state parties to minimize inequalities in income and status of women. Most importantly, from citizens' point of view, is Article 51C from the chapter on fundamental duties, which mandates citizens to renounce all the practices derogatory to the dignity of women. It is also a matter of fact that in pursuance of these constitutional promises and premises, several legislations have been enacted to give women equal status and to make their lives free from violence. This concept of free, violence-free life for women has also gained support and momentum from international convention and treaties. The World Conference on Human Rights at Vienna, held in 1993, has declared human rights of women as inalienable, integral, and indivisible part of human rights. Then came CEDAW, the Convention for Elimination of All Sorts of Discrimination Against Women, which is a major milestone in the history of gender justice. It is a kind of Magna Carta, directing the state parties to protect women against violence of any kind, especially that occurring within family. Important aspect is that it is recognizing gender violence as a discrimination against women. India has ratified this convention and in 1992 itself, and therefore on Indian horizon, this convention is found reflected in the landmark decision of the Supreme Court in the case of Vishakha versus State of Rajasthan, AR 1997 Supreme Court 3011, which lays down various guidelines for prevention of sexual harassment of women at workplace. This judgment is of great importance because in the absence of or in the void of domestic law, the Supreme Court has taken resort to the International Convention and virtually made a law which was prevailing in the field till the recent Act of 2013, Prevention of Sexual Harassment of Women at Workplace, was enacted by the legislature after 16 years from this judgment. This judgment recognizes that sexual harassment of women at workplace is a discrimination and affront to her right to life and dignity as enshrined in Article 21 of the Constitution. This convention of CEDAW is also finding echo in the enactment of the Protection of Women from Domestic Violence Act 2005, which in its object and reasons consciously and refers, expressly refers to this convention, as from this convention only the support is derived to enact the law. The enactment of PWDVA, or Protection of Women from Domestic Violence Act, is a major milestone as regards this domestic violence. As till the enactment of this law, we were recognizing cruelty to a woman as an offense under Section 498A of IPC. But it was not providing women any civil rights as such. And for the first time, this act has conferred or recognized these rights, and it is for preventing the occurrence of domestic violence in the society. The act provides various civil remedies. So without leaving the house, matrimonial home, now she can avail these remedies. The act is innovative, comprehensive, and dynamic in many ways, because for the first time it has broadened the concept of domestic violence to include within its ambits all kinds of abuses and harassment, whether sexual, verbal, emotional, economic. Section 3 of the Act is very wide in its import. Act also recognizes woman's right of residence in her matrimonial home. I mean, till then, we don't have the concept of matrimonial property. We were not recognizing that right either statutory or even judicially. Now, for the first time, the Act has recognized. Otherwise, what used to happen and still happens is the moment domestic violence or marital discord takes place, it is the woman or the wife who has to leave her house, or she is to leave the house. Now, the Act has granted her right of residence in the shared household, and it is irrespective of the her right of ownership or the ownership of her husband or any other person. This Act therefore recognizes her right to secured housing, and which is very important. Having a roof over your head makes a lot of difference for the life of the woman, because now she can at least claim to be safe, though she may not be necessarily. The Act also enables her to get protection orders from the court to restrain her husband or the abuser from subjecting her to domestic violence and from entering in his own house. Again, that is something, you know, Act sometimes, it has come in 2005, and even today we find that these orders, when husband or his family members are restrained from entering in their own house, something, you know, radical concept. And that enables her, I mean, you know, that is was very important right given to her, in addition to her right to get monetary reliefs of maintenance, compensation, and even interim custody of children under one forum. The appointment of protection officers and service providers is also ensured to assist her in getting these reliefs, including medical, legal aid, provision for immediate shelter, etc. The radical nature of the Act is also found reflected in the fact that it recognizes the rights of women in a relationship akin to marriage to get all these rights. The point, the reason why I'm highlighting all these legislation, the constitutional promises, their interpretation by the judiciary, is that at least on paper, every endeavor is meant to bring women at par with men and thereby to secure gender equality. It may be true that there may be certain subtle nuances in law where we still find some gaps in statutory law. For example, women are still not given any right in matrimonial property, even in guardianship rights. She is still not considered the natural guardian along with her father, or the succession rights, where she lags far behind despite amendment to Section 6 of the Hindu Succession Act. It may also be true that the various legal battles she has fought might not have given her the complete victory, or might not have made her fully equal like a man. But they made her realize that it is not a man's world alone, as it was never meant to be, but it is equally a woman's world, as it is meant to be, the world of both men and women. Having said everything, I must again say the fact remains that our society is yet not free from gender bias. This gender bias may be subtle, found reflected in our expectations from her, in our stereotyping, in our beliefs, which turn into norms and then becomes our value system. After all, what is gender bias? Simply put, it is a social construct and comprehends various roles, behaviors, activities, and attributes that a society considers appropriate for male and women. It has nothing to do with biological sex. Our main expectations from men and women are not same. As Simon Beauvoir, De Beauvoir, has very beautifully placed in her book, The Second Sex, that one is not born a woman, but become a woman. It is in upbringing of a girl or a daughter that a woman is born. It is in the expectations of the society that a woman is born. This gender bias is therefore in our stereotyping, our myths, our expectations from her. We may carry this bias, as I said, unconsciously, even without our knowledge, and it may be because of our social baggage. It is found in our desire to have a, it is found reflected in our desire to have a son, in our preference for a male child, which results in declining female sex ratio. With each census after 10 years, we suddenly become aware of the same. And it happens despite the penal laws like the Preconception and Prenatal Diagnostic Technique Act. It is found reflected in our marriage laws, succession laws, not making any legal provision to decide how succession to a self-acquired property can take place in the absence of a husband and children. This gender bias surfaces in our religious rituals and practices when she is denied entry in the temples or dargahs. It is found reflected in our social customs like giving and taking of dowry. Dowry being accepted social custom, we find very few convictions under the Dowry Prohibition Act. Only when she succumbs to dowry tape, the law takes cognizance. Gender bias is there in denial of equal opportunity to her at workplaces, whether it is permanent commission in army or navy. It is in denial of equal pay, equal work conditions, or equal opportunities of career prospects. She has to knock doors of court for it. Sexual harassment at workplace is still a dark secret of her life. It took legislature, as I said, 16 years for enacting the law. The incident of Nirbhaya gang rape that occurred in Delhi 2012 or the Me Too movement proves that her life is still not free from sexual violence. And now COVID-19 has made us again aware of the domestic violence and its gravity. It proves that statistically women is safer on the road at night also amidst the strangers than in her own home, amidst her near and close ones. As it is said, home is where the maximum danger is. The data collected by National Commission for Women shows that the total complaints of domestic violence received during the 68 days of lockdown period were 1.5 times more than the complaints received last year during the same period of March to May. In the last year, the number of complaints received were only 607, and now it is 1,477, that is 1,477. The study conducted by UNFPA has projected an additional 31 million cases of gender-based violence for a period of 6 months under lockdown. It is said that the virus is killing more men than women, and therefore in that way it is partial to women, but then it is having extremely adverse consequences for women who are now trapped at home with their abusers. At a time when support services are disrupted or are inaccessible. This situation is also not limited to India alone, but is prevalent all over the globe. The UN General Secretary has to take note of it and has called for the measures to address, I hear a quote, horrifying global surge in domestic violence, unquote, and has urged all the governments to make prevention and redress of violence against women a key part of their national response plan for COVID-19. While concluding, I must say that addressing domestic violence has become an urgent issue not only for the government, as it is a health issue and criminal act, but also for the society, as it is the societal attitudes which justify domestic violence by both men and women. I mean, I was also surprised when I come across the findings of the survey conducted by UNFPA International Center for Research on Women in 2017-18, which revealed that 52% of women reported that they had experienced some form of violence during their lifetime from husband or intimate partner, and 60%, I mean more 8% men said that they had acted violently against their wife or partner at some point in their lives. As per NCRB data, also every 22 minutes one case of domestic violence takes place. Whereas according to WHO report, violence against women causes more death than all the illnesses put together. What was surprising for me is another survey conducted by National Family Health in the year 2015-16, wherein 42% of the men surveyed believed that it is justified for a man to beat his wife for as trifle a reason as that she did not cook properly or refused to have sex or neglected her household chores. Sometimes the beating also without any reason. And what was more surprisingly is that more than half of the women surveyed also justified beating by husband under certain circumstances. So what is of importance for all of us is creating awareness and understanding both in men and also with women that violence cannot be an acceptable norm of behavior. It must be impressed on everyone that no, not even a single slap can be or need to be tolerated. There has to be a zero violence to such incident. What can be done for that? We have to make our women economically strong and independent and mentally strong, because the root cause of violence is women's powerlessness. In Kerala, it is noticed that literacy rate being high and matriarchal form of family system, women are having comparatively more independence, and hence incidents of domestic violence are also less. We have also to break the silences and change the narratives.
I'll be here at 6:30.
Yes, I will continue. We have to listen to her. There must be avenues open to her to make a complaint and seek assistance. We have to create a strong support system for her. The network of service providers, support services like shelters must be in place. I would like to give an example of the step taken by France government. It has financed the bookings of 20,000 rooms in hotels for the women seeking refuge from domestic violence. It has also set up toll booths at groceries and pharmacies so that women can contact people for help away from home. Other countries like Argentina, Italy, Norway, Spain have adopted Mask 19, wherein a woman can asking for the type of mask is a signal for the person to call help. Spain and Portugal have also declared protection and assistance for victims of gender-based violence as essential service that can operate during lockdown. In our country, the government has launched the helpline. NCW has also provided WhatsApp number. The various high courts like Delhi, Jammu and Kashmir, Karnataka have also given the directions and taken the steps for providing security to women. However, what we have to recognize that the onus of staying safe is not on women, but on us as a society. Women must be able to take safety for granted, just as men do. We have to recognize that women face violence because of deep-rooted social and cultural norms and values that endorse male supremacy and authority. Hence, preventing women from being violated can be possible by addressing discriminatory practices and norms that lead to unequal treatment and women being denied basic rights. We have to teach equality in home and live through daily life. Like charity must begin at our home, the way we bring up our children, the son and daughter. The private spheres of life are the most powerful forces which can accelerate the process of gender equality because it can alter the ways in which women view themselves. The issue of domestic violence or of sexual violence, sexual harassment, gender bias being a breach of human rights, and the violation of right to live with dignity, it deserves utmost consideration. I look forward, here I conclude, and really look forward to the views of co-panelists.
Thank you, ma'am. I was just noting down the way you seamlessly were discussing without going through any of the papers and the number of acts. I was just jostling it down as to whether how many acts you had written. Despite the fact that I was trying to write it down, I found that you had written so many wide spectrum of acts. I thought that the only steno could have done it as how many acts you have done. I noticed that you referred to IPC, you referred to the Sexual Harassment Act, then the Guardianship Act, Domestic Violence Succession Act, Legal Aid, then on different legal judgments which have far-reaching effect, from Vishakha to then this the latest judgment where the ladies were given permanent mission, where you spoke of that, then the Nirbhaya case, Me Too movement, to assimilate all those facts in the right way, as we just said, it shows the immense knowledge and what amount of hard work goes behind that entire webinar or wherever you speak. It shows why people actually want to hear from your side. We're obliged on that part. Before we ask Professor Shashikala to give the insights, I will ask Dr. Harish Shetty. Let's have the...
One minute. Let me come in here.
Yeah, ma'am.
Because we did not give a perspective in linking Harish to some of us who have been here as feminist activists, as judges, as lawyers and law teachers. I thought you will give that call to me and then I will give the introduction.
No, that's fine.
Dr. Joshi will come in. So let me link the themes. First of all, as the communication has come to all of you viewers and co-panelists, we were focusing on the rights of the vulnerable. Now, who are the vulnerable is the first question that you will ask. Vulnerable is not a term that is used in an ordinary sense when we contextualize it in law. We look at it as the etymology of the word, which comes from the word the vulnus, which means an open wound, the gaping wound. So in the societal context, it's about vulnerability, is about susceptibility to suffering or pain. So if you look at certain segments of our society who are labeled as disadvantaged, or in the constitution also this kind of term has been used, the weaker sections. So we can say that they come within the vulnerability, but these are very socioeconomically determined by external criteria kind of segments. When we talk about vulnerability, I would go by Martha Fineman's extensive work and European Court of Human Rights talking about vulnerability in the case of Roma women or the linguistic minority, or in case of people who have been unjustly incriminated in anti-terrorism law. The vulnerability there is about one's susceptibility to be discriminated, one's susceptibility to pain, susceptibility to suffering. Legal profession as such has been the champion of the vulnerable. If you look at the profession in Indian context, in countries like India, which are in the developing bloc of the world, with a lot of socio-economic inequalities still prevailing, have reflected the idea of vulnerability in legislations, as Madam mentioned, which are looking at legal aid or services, special provisions in the constitution. So from that point of view, the idea of vulnerability needs to be looked deep into the reality of the cases beyond these segments and legislations. I will give you an example. In the domestic violence case itself, whenever you talk about domestic violence, the well-read, the elite segments of the society say, oh, that all happens in the illiterate segments of the society. That all happens, it must be happening among the poor. But if you look at the legislation and the way in which cases have come before the court and the pattern, the vulnerability there is much deeper than socioeconomic segmentation. It's much deeper than the gender alone. So look at this case of a millionaire's wife who is given just 70 rupees a week of allowance for herself, who with those 70 rupees, if she's going to spend those 70 rupees, husband will ask for all the details. And then her phone is tapped. She's not allowed to get out of the house unless somebody in the, some elder or somebody in the house permits. So these kinds of situations will show that vulnerability is something to be seen much more than the physical dimension. It is to be seen much more than the socioeconomic status. For example, I can become vulnerable even though I'm a very educated person who has got access to all the privileges in the society. If I leave the borders of my country and become an alien in another country, I could become vulnerable when suddenly I become a minority because of the provision of the law or because of a ruler who has got certain attitude towards certain groups and therefore legislations are discriminating, ordinances are discriminating, or rules are discriminating. So today we have vulnerability getting more complex because of the pandemic. So we have seen the cases of the migrant. We have seen the cases of domestic violence, as Madam put it. So I would suggest that our vulnerability series, in which we are doing this first discussion on gender, domestic violence, and harassment at workplace, is to be seen from the point of view of a biological determinism and a biological construct of that determinism in a social context, resulting in discrimination, resulting in pain, and resulting in suffering. So I would like to place before you the way in which the cost of violence has been coming to the society and that hasn't been factored in. For example, Rajasthan state alone had a study conducted by a group of Tata Institute sociologists and Galway University's legal researcher showing thousands of crores of loss because of the women remaining absent from work due to the after effect of domestic violence. So this is a larger issue that needs to be discussed, because domestic violence is not just the violation of the right or pain or suffering by that woman or child or elderly member of the family alone. It has a social cost. It has a larger ramification for the humanity. Secondly, I would like to highlight here that when we recognize the vulnerable section, we look at the impairment in reasoning, impairment in decision making, impairment in terms of making sense of the world. So that is where we look at vulnerability from the psychological point of view, from the mental health point of view. So if someone is succumbing or someone is not raising a voice, not reacting to domestic violence, there must be some reason operating behind that mind. There must be a dynamism by which that mind is operating. That is where mental health issue comes in. And that's where people like Dr. Shetty assume a lot of importance in this forum. I would like to say that as activists, I was taking up cases of these women. Invariably, we knew that despite our advice, despite best of the legal support provided, alternative notives provided after assessing their cases, women would go back to the situation. So I did not get the answer why this was happening. Doesn't she have a self-respect? Doesn't she have a dignity? How can she be happy with the perpetrator who has been day in and day out beating her, insulting her, ridiculing her? Then I read an article by UN rapporteur Rhonda Capellon in this book on human rights of women, an exclusive chapter on how domestic violence is similar to the violence that happens in the prison and how it becomes equivalent to prison. So she raises three important dynamics of violence, which happens at the hands of someone that you trust, at the hands of someone with whom you enter into vows of intimate relationship and cohabitation, and maybe lifelong union in the form of rituals, saptapati, etc. So first point she raises is that the way in which the violence destroys the capacity to think, the capacity to reason. She compares it to the helplessness that is cultivated by an animal which is leashed. So the animal would go to the leash next day without being beaten or without being shouted at. Secondly, she also tells about how repressed emotions and response to violence results in sudden outbursts, and that's how the the lady ends up killing her perpetrator. So battered woman syndrome has been explained by her in a very, very deeper way. Third aspect that she talks about is that this helplessness that the woman undergoes is not a natural helplessness, it's a cultivated helplessness. So how does this helplessness get cultivated is a dynamic that we would expect Dr. Shetty to reflect upon. So overall, the vulnerability in case of a trusted home, home which should have been the safest place for the person, becoming the most dreaded place, becoming a place where human rights have been constantly violated, is a dynamic that needs to be seen. The second dimension that I would like to add here is that when these women were advised to go to counselor or to a psychiatrist, their file was not called as file on violence or file on 498A or file on case of torture. That file used to be called as yellow file by psychologists, file on stress. So these two impute it to the stress that is cultivated in the relationship due to one's own limitation or due to the dynamic between the two people, and also some external factors like in-laws, socioeconomic factors, etc. So this is where the law needs to factor in psychology and psychiatry, and psychiatry needs to factor in the dimension of dignity and human rights. I always saw a kind of diversion between the two. Unless the judges were or lawyers were enlightened or activists were enlightened in the psychological dynamic, or the psychiatrists or psychological counselors were very much aware of the dignity and the rights that were available to these women, the way in which the communication and the language was used in these cases made a lot of difference in the outcome of the case. So breaking the cycle of violence, making the perpetrator to realize that what that person is doing is not right and the kind of impact it is creating on the survivor or the victim, and the way in which this pathology of violence escalates as the time goes, and the shrinking cycle, I mean, they have a language called flower and shower state, where the perpetrator would abuse and then he would say, look what you made me to do. And then he would bring a garland of flower, in Indian context, garland of flower or a box of sweets, and then he would bite the victim so that next time the violence is going to be more intense. So this is called the cycle of flower and shower. In domestic violence, the longer the person stays in the relationship, how this stage gets longer and frequent and frequent is something that is to be understood by all of us. Another thing that Rhonda talks about in her article is about the myths in domestic violence and the reality. First myth, as Madam said, is the myth that if this woman is staying in this relationship, then she loves to be beaten. Is that true? Nobody likes to be beaten. It's just that she believes that the person will transform, or she believes that what is she doing must be causing this person to behave that way. She feels responsible for his behavior. And the reality is that they have beaten for silly reasons like the meal was cold or that the child was crying, you know. So who is responsible for whose behavior is the reality that needs to be asked. Second myth, there are many other myths. Second myth is that if you leave this spouse, then you become orphan. Others will make fun of you. There's a stigma against a woman who lives single with little children. Children will become more vulnerable to other predators. So these kinds of thought processes operate behind the mind of the women. But then the reality is that children, when they watch their parents fighting or one of the parents being insulted and beaten, anyway get psychologically affected, which Dr. Shetty might highlight better. So in these cases, the reality is that the woman is not independent, or she doesn't have the awareness, or she doesn't have the support, necessary support from the family or the society. We have seen that in the Vimochana public trial way back in 1999, large percentage of families who came and shed tears in the public trial said that we had the signs, but we did not heed those signs. We sent the girl back to her house saying that somehow adjust, it will all be all right, only to realize that either she committed suicide or she was burned to death. So this is how escalation of violence is some phenomenon that needs to be viewed seriously. The reality is that those who engage in violence are having certain type of mindset. They have deep values which are not at all healthy. As Madam Shalini highlighted, certain strong stereotypes operating in their mind. that if it is wife, she needs to serve me, she needs to listen to me, she needs to do what I ask her to say, and if she violates, she needs to be punished. So these kinds of mindsets and patriarchal values seem to be operating in the minds of these persons. And then when they undergo proper mental health orientation, there have been changes. I do not know the percentage would come from Dr. Shetty. So our question in this case is, what are the strategies? What is the kind of discretion that women need to use? How long can violent relationship prevail? I mean, we have a provision in the Dowry Prohibition Act within 7 years of marriage. What kind of a scientific basis is there that beyond 7 years of marriage, there is no harassment related to dowry? You know, which study has been taken in this, or which scientific basis on the human behavior has been relied on, is a wonder that I always had when I looked around and had seen cases where perpetually the demand is there. Another point I would like to take is the workplace harassment aspect, which Madam has highlighted. Between the Vishakha case of 1997 and the Medhalele case in 2012, there was barely any implementation of the guidelines of the judgment. Hence, the Medhalele case brought before the Supreme Court highlighted the need for a legislation. So in 2013, December, the legislation was passed. By 2014, it was to be implemented. It did not get implemented in the way it was expected. In Pune, we had a forum under the CII where Divya Chavan was involved in highlighting and creating awareness to various segments of industry. And we realized that the implementation was far from reality. Today, we realize that in workplace harassment also, the stereotypes operate. Now, these stereotypes are the stereotypes that women are constant absentees, women are not very motivated, they don't make great leaders. Why should I take orders from a woman leader? So, where the leadership and modeling of gender within the organization doesn't exist, workplace harassment connects to that. Second is, wherever harassers have used their power position to take undue advantage, these harassers have been made to leave the organization, have been made to undergo inquiry, but then they go elsewhere, they get recruited promptly without any kind of undertaking or background check, and they repeat the process. I do not want to mention the name. In one of the very, very famous organizations, this person left the organization, went back to another organization and repeated the behavior. So whether the behavioral dimension in case of workplace harassment has been factored into recruitment is an issue that needs to be seen from the larger angle of governance and management. The other aspect that I would like to highlight in workplace harassment as well as domestic violence is affecting life itself. Workplace harassment is affecting right to livelihood. So both are finally connected to the sacrosanct Supreme Article 21, which relates to life, life with dignity, livelihood, survival. So these both issues need to be taken very, very seriously, and the vulnerability of one segment of the society to the violation of this right needs to be viewed from the legal angle, from the mental health angle, from the policy angle, and socioeconomic reforms. I would like to highlight here also that we have had a situation in workplace harassment which is a very unique situation, which scholar Deborah Rod of Stanford University has highlighted. This situation is what we call a subtle sexism, where a woman who doesn't fit into the normal stereotype of a beautiful woman, nice woman, might also get targeted, or a woman who gains weight during the course of the job, which happens, you know, because hormones act, maternity acts on the body. Them being fired in a very indirect way by being told that, oh, you are not that presentable, therefore you better be shifted to the backhand office. Yeah. These things happen in a very subtle way. Another is where maternity becomes a kind of invisible glass ceiling in some organizations for growth and development of women. These kinds of harassments have not been captured because the word sexual is mainly captured in terms of bodily oriented comments. So the word sexual there in terms of subtle sexism and sexism as a mindset resulting in certain behaviors needs to be incorporated into the vocabulary of the law. Another point I would like to highlight both in domestic violence and sexual harassment law is that gender is not biological alone, as Madam said, it's abiological. So we have had cases of gay people being fired out of job because they look like an aesthetic slur. This hasn't been recorded in the inquiry or in the documentation, but there is a bias against this. There has been a bias. So now with the various legislations, etc., I mean, this month is also the Pride Month, you know. So for me, it is a very important dimension. So we have a long way to go, because there is a UNDP report which says that when it is gender-based discrimination or gender-based violence, the male cognate in the relationship, whether it is heterosexual relationship or homosexual relationship, ends up becoming a perpetrator on the female cognate. The male-female cognate need not be necessarily biological, because these are masculinity and femininity which have been associated with certain traits and certain behaviors, which have been repeatedly recast in the society by our discursive practices, by the media, and by the dominant values in the society. Something which is connected as male equivalent or masculine is considered as a value, it is worship. Something which is considered as female is considered as something to be dominated. The dominant is the male and the dominated is the female. So these cognates operate. Therefore, that UNDP report also highlights that even in heterosexual relationship, man-woman relationship, 5% of the relationships show woman being the perpetrator. So these are the kinds of thought processes that we need to challenge. So I would like the House to discuss these issues. In case of COVID, these disparities and these circumstances became more highlighted due to the pandemic situation. Lockdown resulted in a situation where the perpetrator is watching the perpetrator. So the perpetrator was not able to pick the phone and call. Jaguri, this non-governmental organization, recognizes or records that the number of phone calls came down during COVID on their helpline. That means that it doesn't mean that during COVID violence came down. The fieldwork of our team in Pune highlights that on an average daily 2 to 3 cases were coming to the police station. And the police were really trying to battle the situation of the COVID patrolling. So these cases could not be given the attention. Finally, the seriousness resulted in a committee which had a healthcare worker as well as ASHA worker as well as the police, whereby they came out with some ad hoc measures. One of the ad hoc measures was to isolate the perpetrator, to engage with some work like cleaning a government office or having a kind of isolation in the government office. So this shows that domestic violence needs to be, or any form of violence needs to be seen not only as an issue of right and justice to battle with, but the dimensions of healthcare, especially mental health, need to be incorporated into it. Whereas in case of physical wounds, the physical health also needs to be incorporated into it. So I'm throwing these perspectives open to the House, and I would request the moderator to take over and steer the discussion.
Thank you, ma'am. The insights which you have given, the different aspects have been touched. And I would ask Dr. Harish Shetty to...
Oh, no, I would ask Mrs. Kapoor to talk, and I would want to listen to this learned reference-based discussion, and then I'll come in, if you don't mind.
I can ask. I will. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yeah. I would really like to hear the participants and get their questions now, because I don't think we have a lot of time. But I'll just make about 2 or 3 points. Both the distinguished panelists before me have done an already comprehensive and insightful presentations. So I'm going to sort of push back a little bit by saying that despite decades of law reform in the area of women's rights, violence continues to happen. Violence continues to be a fact of life in the lives, not just of women, but also as Director Bhupur said, it's a fact in the lives of the vulnerable. So we have to, I believe we're at a point where we have to sit back a little bit and be rather reflective. What has gone wrong? Why has it that so much law, despite so much law reform, more rights has not led to more equality or less violence? And I think it's a very important question. We have some good laws. The domestic violence law was a fantastic piece of legislation. I think it's amongst one of the best. But I'd also think, let me just take one step back, is that all legislation that we have needs to be informed by a rights discourse. You know, you can't just have a criminalization of conduct without rights being the non-negotiable, all right? So it, and I think this came out so beautifully after the tragic and horrible 2012 gang rape and murder, in the protests that followed. And I remember the placards saying, "We're not your mother, we're not your wife." This young men and women, both, you know, so there's a whole new generation, I think, who's really very vocal, and are the students that we, many of us, teach now, who said, "We are not your wives, we're not your mothers, we're not your sisters. We're citizens of India who are entitled to equal rights." And I believe that that really was very powerful in telling us how you cannot keep on linking rights to one's role and status within a family, because that notion of family is very narrow and very limited. It's, as Dr. Gurpura actually mentioned, you know, it's heteronormative. It's actually also monogamous. It doesn't, it excludes a whole spectrum of individuals and alternative family arrangements. And I think it's very sad, coming back to the Domestic Violence Act, which I said was inclusive of so many categories. It's the courts which actually narrowed the provisions. And it's the courts that narrowed our definition of household, shared household. And it's also the courts that narrowed the definition of which women were entitled to protection. So it created a hierarchy, right? And I believe that the intention was to include all women, all vulnerable groups within these shared households, which was supposed to be very, it was supposed to be a very expansive understanding of what constituted a shared household. It would include single women, it would include widows, it would include divorced women, it would include sex workers, and it would include my sexual, religious, caste, minority women. So it seems to me it got really very narrowed in the course of the judicial intervention. It's a rare example of our judiciary actually narrowing women's rights as opposed to expanding it. A second issue, I think, and so, the other issue I wanted to mention is that there's this very progressive bit in the domestic violence legislation, which actually links marital rape to civil rights. And I think that's hugely important. At the same time, despite the 2012 protests and advocacy and all the proposals that came in, marital rape continues to be exempted from the criminal law. Now, in my, and this is really in my analysis of the law, had we only asked for the criminalization of marital rape and nothing else, I think we would have achieved an enormous amount. So all the other legislation that happened, or law reform that happened, most of it was actually cherry picking, because there were some really good proposals. Even if we hadn't had that, because remember, all the four who were convicted were actually tried under the old law, and they were convicted, and they were sentenced, and they were executed under the old law, which basically meant the old law worked, if you, you know, excluding the death penalty part. And so you wonder, what was all this new law about if the one fundamental change could not have be brought about, which, as I say, is the criminalization of marital rape. The second problem, I think, and this is becoming more evident, this is more evident in the sexual harassment interventions, is that the core right that women and all these alternative communities have been demanding is a right to sexual autonomy and bodily integrity, as informing every legal standard and not being negotiable. Once again, unfortunately, our overwhelming focus on sexual wrongs has actually been done at the cost of sexual rights. and even gender rights. The result is now we know a lot of sexual conduct is eliminated, despite even if it's consensual, including sexual speech, you know, sort of creating an environment in which we can have health conversations, healthy conversations around sex and sexuality and gender, is now in fact targeted speech under some of the ways in which the sexual harassment laws have been interpreted. So I'm wondering, it's not the problem so much with the law, it's the views about women and men and families and sexuality that inform the interpretation of these laws that have actually not necessarily proved to be liberating or emancipating. I'm going to stop there because I think, as I said, the legislation and the insights presented by our other distinguished panelists have already been very comprehensive. Thank you,
ma'am. Before we call upon Dr. Harish Shetty, we are fortitious enough and we are quite happy also that Justice Moshmi Bhattacharya from Calcutta High Court has joined. We are unmuting her and we would ask ma'am to give the insights before we ask Dr. Harish Shetty. We have heard all sides. We are too happy that she has joined us. Yes, ma'am, we have... Ma'am, you will have to unmute yourself. Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, you have now your video.
The mic
is on,
has to be unmuted, yes, on the, yes, screen.
Yes, ma'am, it has to be from her side. Ma'am, unmute yourself.
Yes,
please.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, sorry, Dr. Shetty, I didn't want to come in.
I'm lucky to hear you also.
Fortuitous or otherwise, I didn't want to interrupt the session. I was enjoying myself very much. Because what I suggest is let Dr. Shetty please address the session. And after he's done, then I'll just give one or two thoughts. That's all.
Okay.
I think that the flow will be much better.
It's fine.
Thank you.
A decade and a half back, when I was conducting a session for judges at Jyoti, Judicial Officers Training Institute, I was tempted to ask a provocative question. How many of you beat up your wives? And believe it or not, there were quite a few, one third or one fourth of them, they put their hand and said, "Manje kai, raag ala tar ami haath uchalto." And that opened my eyes completely. And I've said that beliefs don't change by acts, by laws. Beliefs which are very deep down take a long time to change. In the corona period, we were trying to convert, we were trying to educate women who believed they were martyrs into managers. I still remember this young teacher from my school where I run. I said, in the morning, get up and give tasks to everybody. And you do not do everything inside the house. After a week, she came and said that, "Doctor, I tried, but ultimately I landed up doing everything myself." Then I explored, how did this happen? This did not happen because others did not want to work, but the deep-rooted belief of martyrdom, of I'm a good bahu, I'm a good wife, I'm a good daughter, and I'm a good mother, is so strong in the Indian psyche. Education has not cleared it, and education will take a long time to clear it. When I look at all this, I look at NCRB data, the latest which is available as of now, which Madam Pansalkar Joshi also quoted. One out of five people who end their life by suicide are daily wage laborers, and one out of six are housewives. There's something which should open our eyes. One out of three causes for ending one's life are family problems, and family problems also include domestic violence. There's an increased ratio of girls under 18 committing suicide more than boys. So this is a big change in the last few years. The number of girls ending their lives early is also on the rise. Now, when I look at all this, when I see people coming to me, I see that those who do not complain about domestic violence, most of them have childhood trauma. Many of them have seen violence among their own parents. That's one of the most important reasons for learned helplessness. Many of them have had child sexual abuse. And that is also one of the most correlates, I would say, not the causes, but correlates, which has been responsible for not reporting violence and not fighting it out. Patriarchy is something we all know. One important factor which we really use when we train young boys and girls, all those girls who have poor self-worth about their bodies, for whatever reason. I mean, simple words. I still remember a family who's my friend's sister. Whenever I would go to their home, since last 25 years, she would cook all the time and make great food and great recipes for us. After I took up psychiatry, I asked her, why do you do this? What is it that you get? She said, I feel nice when I feed everybody. But as a psychiatrist, we don't accept all the sentences on face value. We believe that behind the sentences are certain behaviors. And she said that my grandmother would always say, ni karpu, you are dark, your brother is fair. That was enough for her to break her entire ecosystem in the mind. And she started abusing herself for helping others. And that, I think, is also extremely important for us to understand. All the women who have broken free from abuse, I found three reasons. One is financial independence. Remember, financial independence is not about holding a job. That's not financial independence. Financial independence is able to control your money. And that is financial independence. It's not about I have a job, I have a bank balance. No, that bank balance is controlled by me and it's in my hands. The second most important factor for women breaking free is support, not from the family, but from peers. It is her friends, her colleagues, her schoolmates, boys or girls, who support her to resist to violence and take action. And the last would be support from the family. When we look at all this, the journey from martyrdom to empowerment is too long. It's not about education. It's not about laws. It's about the collective unconscious here. And to break that, and to really break that, the efforts have to be multi-pronged, but the efforts also have to be repairing the stories in her own mind. And that is, I think, extremely important. Now, when we also look at the entire phenomenon of violence, violence is not about physical beating. A lot of women come and tell me rubbish. They said it is karma. It is karma. As a psychiatrist, I also practice a lot of advocacy because I have lawyers, I have many other friends whom I refer and they take action. But many women have shown me the mark and said, it is my karma. Maybe in the past birth, I have violated him. And in this birth, you will not believe, I'm not talking about uneducated women. I'm talking about educated, PhD qualified women. I think this entire business of karma is so wonky, interpreted so differently. I still remember this woman who was beaten up by her doctor husband, and because he was in love with another doctor in his hospital, and he left her. And she was taking therapy from my psychologist. Suddenly she felt she changed. I said, how did you change so fast? And I was very happy that my therapist had done a great job. It was not that. She did some past life regression, and some stupid past life regression therapy said, pichle janam mein tumne uska fasaya, is janam mein wo. So the whole lot of words are giving different meanings to women when they are abused. And this is also a big hindrance with respect to empowerment. Lastly, breaking the cycle of learned helplessness is very difficult. Learned helplessness is, as ma'am was asking, I am beaten up. I feel I'm unlucky. I deserve. And then I suddenly start accepting it as new normal. And if you're not beaten up, you're very surprised. So this learned helplessness takes a long time to break, because you have inculcated, ingrained the fact that this is extremely normal. Now, lastly, so that I can hear Honorable Justice Moshami Bhattacharya. Lastly, violence was a part of belief, but today violence is also part of angst. Very important. Globalization has not allowed us to sit quietly. Well, globalization has disconnected us. Coronavirus has reconnected our family. In a very strange way, Corona has told us, you're not meeting your family, please sit down and have food together. But unfortunately, the National Women's Commission said that they have increased number of calls of domestic violence after the lockdown. So angst would mean violence which is new. It was not that earlier. It is new. It started approximately 6 months ago, a year ago. One needs to explore there is something wrong in the mind of the person who's violent. If it has been part of his nature or his belief, it was different. And there we find that a lot of men or women who get depressed are very agitated, angry, and violent. I will kill you or I'll kill myself and I better beat you up. And unfortunately, they meet the wrong lawyers. And when they meet the wrong lawyers, the route which they should take in terms of helping is not met. And that is something we need to really look at. Lastly, I have a WhatsApp group of single men and single women who are fighting the laws, fighting the cases in the family court. When the man does not pay interim maintenance, when the man resists giving away his rights, the first thing a lawyer tells the woman is, DB thok do. And that is also a truism. And the woman said, I did not want to file the DV, but the lawyer said, if I file the DV, I will get the compensation, I will get the incremental. So we need to look at this entire issue in a holistic manner. We can't look it through an ideological prism. We can't look it at through a prism of personal beliefs or personal faiths and ideologies. We need to look at holistically, we need to look at all aspects of the issue, and every case of domestic violence may not be the same as the other, and that is something which is very important. So at the end, I would say the route from martyrdom to empowerment is long. We can shorten it by working it on it in many creative ways. Thank you. Sorry, Honorable Justice Moshami.
Not at all, Dr. Shetty. It was a real pleasure hearing you. I've actually heard you in one of the other talks arranged by the Maharashtra Judicial Academy. And let me take also the opportunity of thanking Professor Gurpur, Professor Kapoor, and of course, last but not the least, Justice Joshi, who I've briefly interacted with you in Bhopal, I remember. Very engaging session, very interesting points raised. And Professor Kapoor, it's actually quite significant that you made the point that it is actually one of the rare areas where the judiciary has restricted or narrowed down some of the rights conferred under the Protection of Women from Domestic Violence Act 2005. In that context, you know, yesterday I read a very recent judgment of the Supreme Court delivered sometime in April 2020. It's the cause title is, I think, Aishwarya. Let me give you the exact cause title: Aishwarya Atul Pusalkar versus Maharashtra Housing, and the citation is 2020 SEC online page 408. In that, actually, I found a very kind of significant observation, not really the ratio there, but by way of an obiter, that what is the concept of a matrimonial home? And the matrimonial home issue was discussed against the concept of shared household under what is it's section 2.5. Of the 2S of the 2005 Act, and later on also comes in again under section 17. What is a shared household? And in that case, the wife who had been successful in a divorce proceedings claimed a part of the husband's flat Delhi, Shivaji Park, Delhi, which had been demolished. And she claimed a part of that flat as her matrimonial home, basing her claim on the common law rights, on the rights given to her under the Hindu law as wife. And the court, by way of obiter, said that the correct route is not through an Article 226 writ petition, but you will have to go through the family court, or you have to file a civil court to get that redress. Mutt made some very interesting observations on the right of a woman to have her matrimonial home protected, to have a place of stay, and the concept of shared household. And also brought in the concept of economic abuse under Section 3.4 of the 2005 Act, and said that, in a line, said that a wife cannot be dishoused, that's the coinage, dishoused from her matrimonial home during the pendency of proceedings. Now, having said that, the only reason why I mentioned this judgment is that, contrary to some of the views which I came across in this session, the 2005 Act, I find that whatever rights it confers on women who are undergoing the trauma, the proceedings, as it were, and I would look at sections 18 to 22 of the Act. Section 18, of course, gives the protection orders. 19, for all those of you who don't have the book in front of you, 19 gives the residence orders, 20 monetary reliefs, 21 custody orders, and 22 compensation orders. I get the feeling, and you I would invite your insights on that, that all these measures are kind of dispendence, in the nature of dispendence while the proceedings are going on, but not really in the nature of any kind of affording final relief to the victim, if I can use that word. All these protective measures are to give that amount of security or comfort to a person while she or he is undergoing the trauma of domestic violence. But if we were to look beyond the act and look for a kind of a definitive closure to what that person is suffering, I don't think the act really provides that, subject to your views. That's my observation number one. Number two is, very briefly, I came across, I think, an article somewhere in the last couple of days, that one of the incidents of this pandemic is an alarming trend of a duality, quote-unquote duality, in domestic violence cases, as in, the men who are actually going out and helping people who are COVID affected are the ones who are beating up their wives at home, or sons who are doing their neighborhood duties and feeding the hungry are keeping their mother hungry in the house. This is really a duality which struck me. It's something which kind of escapes our eyes. So that is the second issue I had. And this is just by way of an intervention comment in response to a very interesting and engaging session. So I would really love to have your insights on that, your response to that. Yes, Vikas.
Thank you, ma'am. The fact that you just joined us and the way you presented the entire issues, it's quite fascinating. I will ask Professor Shashikala that certain questions have already started coming on the chat box.
Right.
So if the ma'am permits, then we can start taking few questions. Anybody out of this platform can respond.
Before taking questions, I would like to respond to one of the observations. I mean, both the observations by Justice Bhattacharya was very, very timely and very, very pointed observations. Her idea of from the article what she has picked, the duality. In Maharashtra also, in our field observation, we had seen in Pune that these men who were otherwise going to work were confined at home for the first time for 2 months or 3 months at a go. They would pester the woman to cook meals. Usually they would have the breakfast, leave the home, come back for dinner, or they would carry a lunch or whatever. So they would ask for repeated meals, and this woman would be either a working woman who is confined at home or maybe a homemaker. But then she was not used to doing this. She also needed her own time for herself, and this was least cared for. So what we see in the root of this is the myth of service, that she's there to serve. Like how my mother served, she better serve me. So expectations, the whole expectation and the power game which is there. We had come across a case in Rajasthan in our literature where the call had come to National Women's Commission's helpline, where the father of the girl had called on a condition of anonymity that the husband of the girl, who is a teacher, was not providing her proper meals. I mean, she was starved. Similarly, we had cases of, in Maharashtra, we had, in the field, we had cases of people trying to not to provide sanitizers, not to provide, because the woman is economically independent. So finally, it points to what Justice Shalini pointed out, the unequal power relationship and the kind of lack of focus on women's development. Like, Kerala has, Madam was mentioning about the Kerala example, even Amartya Sen is a great fan of Kerala in terms of women's empowerment. I come from the border area of Kerala. We have a matrilineal culture where the woman heads the family and she takes claim to the family property. What we see there is in Kerala is even the policy now is focusing on a concept called Kutumbashri, where development is family-centric and woman-centric. Woman leads the development process. Unless such changes happen, if you see the statistical analysis of domestic violence, they are very closely bound up with the increasing numbers in states where female feticide is also high. So finally, they point out to the idea of lack of dignity or value to the life of woman. So this is something that needs to be seen, madam, in response to your very, very astute observation. Yes. Thank you for enriching this
Thank
discussion.
Thank you very much. Yeah. Thank you very much.
So, over to you, Vikas, please.
Ma'am, one could be that since we have all, you all five have discussed on the different issues, there are pointed observations and which are quite relevant. We can take the movement forward because certain questions are invariably as to whether the acts are for so long in existence, as to whether the discussions do actually lead forward. There's one question on that aspect. And we are always discussing about the relation of women in recent times, especially with the pandemic. And men are also abused, then what is your take? If personally believing, I believe that we have discussed the larger perspectives. This issues amongst ourselves, somebody takes a question and the other person can answer. That will probably redress the issues in a righter way. That's my personal take. Professor Shashikala can... put the motion in the right sense, because messages which are coming, they are primarily on the basis that these acts are in existence for long. We have been discussing these issues for long, but how do we move forward? So that's my personal take, that let's assume Dr. Shetty has his experience, or Justice Shalini has her experience, Ratna Kapoor ma'am has her experience, Justice Moshmi has her experience. So a question can be poised by one, the other could be redressed in the right perspective, because we have on the platform men and women of immense knowledge. So their sharing of knowledge with their personal experience as a judge or as a while teaching in a faculty, that I think will give a in a writer perspective. We can ask Professor Ratna Kapoor to take things slightly in a forward manner. We are asking her to unmute her so that she puts the things, because she was the one, the pioneer in large issues which we are today seeing the nation moving forward. Ma'am, could you just unmute yourself? Yes.
So the question here is about that gender neutral protection of law. against the need to protect women. I mean, there's audience have been highlighting that point. Can we make both these laws gender neutral? If we make it gender neutral, what are the consequences? I mean, I would be very cautious, but I don't know what Ratna thinks. So, Ratna, please.
Ma'am, Ratna, ma'am, try to unmute yourself. Ratna Kapoor, ma'am.
You will have to go to your screen, go to that microphone icon at the bottom.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Ma'am, in this entire platform, what happens is we only allow someone to be unmuted. So once you mute yourself again, the entire process has to be redone. Yes,
because
ma'am.
Because I'm coughing, I don't want to. Anyway, let me just get to the points here. I think we have to take a step away from the legislation. And I think both judges have talked about this a little bit as well. As I said, we got to go back to fundamentals, which is about rights. You see, it's no use having gender neutral legislation if those who are impacted don't have rights in the first place. All right. So if you're talking about, say, couples in interreligious relationships that are non-marital or that are non-heterosexual, or you have to first of all ensure they have rights to live together, to have consensual relationships in the first place. That means fundamentally ensuring the protection of the right to sexual autonomy and one's bodily integrity. That is simply fundamental. And I think every law needs to be evaluated against that. And if we don't do that, we're just going to have a lot of legislation that continues to be interpreted according to a very sexist, homophobic, and a culture that actually have a very narrow understanding of which relationships are legitimate and which women are entitled to rights. In other words, which women are redressed as fully formed human subjects and those who are not, and therefore not entitled to rights, okay? So I think it has to go back to something really quite fundamental, that we have to address, first of all, those who are not entitled to exist as human beings in the first place, and therefore not entitled to the protection of this legislation. And secondly, if you have gender neutral legislation, it can be used to target those very people whose full subjectivity has not been recognized in law, right? And so I think that's really important. I'll give a sex worker as an example, or those who live in non-marital relationships, for example. They'll be the very prime targets of gender-neutral legislation. So you can't have gender-neutral legislation that deals with wrongs before you have legislation or cases and a judiciary that supports everyone's rights. And that's not set up this hierarchy. And I think that is something that judges as well as the legislature need to be more conscious of. Even those who are members of progressive groups, right? We have to interrogate our own views and positions as well. We can be deeply sexist and deeply homophobic and deeply sort of anti-minority in our positions without realizing it's become part of so-called common sense. Okay, so I think that is absolutely vital as well. I think there's not been enough also addressed on the kind of masculine cultures we are promoting in our society. India is supposed to be a country that has arrived. We want to be on the Security Council. We want to be in human rights bodies. We want to be, you know, in the WTO. We want to be everywhere to show that we've arrived. But we really haven't. We also have a toxic form of masculinity that we cultivate in our homes, on our streets, in our workplaces, that needs to be addressed. And men need to be part of that, need to be not just saying, for example, if you're on any panel, let me just give you a very small example. If you're on a panel that's not to do with gender and it's only men speaking, men have an obligation on that panel to say, why are we all just men here? Right? It shouldn't be for women. It's not the job of women. and others, or those who are part of human rights advocacy, to point this out. It should become part of a natural thing. You should feel uncomfortable that there's not more diversity on a panel. Okay? And that is true of our courts as well. Let's look at the Supreme Court. Let's look at how many women have actually come being at the high court level. I'm sure, I greatly respect the judges who are present here today, because it must have been a huge struggle to be where you are. It really must have been. But it's also something that we need to really, really seriously address. It's a problem in the 21st century that we just continue to hold out India, at least in its face, as a male country, where women in a public space or in public positions are an exception. That's really problematic. Okay, stop there.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, since I believe that Shalini ma'am had set the entire session into motion, her insights, because she has heard the different panelists on a different way. So the insights thereafter, as they say, back to square one. So I will ask not on the aspects that back to square one, that we have not discussed anything in the right perspective. Back to square one only on the aspect that from where we started, we will ask Shalini ma'am to just give her a take on this, or she can ask someone.
Thank you. Thank you so much. What I feel is that when we are considering the gender bias, the domestic violence, and also the vulnerabilities, it is not only the women who are vulnerable. Sometimes children are also vulnerable. That aspect also we have to consider. We have also to consider, as we have done, that some questions were also raised. Why we don't have the laws protecting men also, just as we are having the laws to protect women. But then the question is, harassment of men is yet not a norm, just as harassment of women has become a norm, or domestic violence cases are coming from women only. So from that angle, it was really, enlightening to take the perspective of Professor Ratna Kapoor also, because she has been instrumental, and since long she is working in this field. She has some justified or maybe rightful reservations as to how the act has been interpreted, especially DV Act or other act, and how we have to look forward to bring a diversified view, how the legal profession as such, judiciary as such, may be male dominated. Now we are finding more women in this field, and they are making their voice heard. Sometimes, their perspectives are making the change. Like we have seen the Vishakha judgment, it was Justice Sujata Manohar, who was the member of that bench, and her inputs, her contribution has made the change. We are having a really, landmark decision. We are having the judgment of Justice Ranjana Desai in Vignesh Arnavekar, where she has said that, giving a slap, it cannot be a norm, or it cannot be a norm at all. And we have such observations coming from anywhere, whether as an advocate or as a judge, they are to be deprecated. So it is not that you are having only the judgments of judiciary which are taking the, may not be that broadened view, but somewhere, it is the judiciary which has broadened that concept, which has brought in the concept of gender justice. There are several series of judgments from the Air India versus Nargesh Mirza, or so many other judgments up to date. The just last judgment of Sabrimala, take it, or it may be of the judgment of entry of women in, or getting their permanent commission in Army or Navy. So we are, judiciary is making its contribution in making the laws more gender proactive. One may say that. It is a contribution, but as she has rightly said, having the well-placed legislation is also not sufficient. Its implementation is also of importance. And in Domestic Violence Act, we have found that implementation is conspicuously lacking, but because the support systems which are created under the Act, maybe protection officer, maybe that of service providers, those systems are yet not in place at various places. I mean, unless we are having the systems in place, whether shelters, one-stop center, crisis centers, we can't, merely having a good piece of legislation will not serve the purpose. So everyone has to act together, whether it is legal profession, judiciary, whether legislation. And ultimately, we have to take to this view. It is not a pure legal issue, and therefore it being a social legal issue, we have to take a holistic view of the matter. We have to see how the women can be more empowered, more strengthened, how we change our belief systems, how we make them aware, how we make them, build up, equip themselves. So these are all the issues which are required to be considered both in our lives, day-to-day lives, in our home, and also in our schools. I mean, still now we don't have the course on gender justice in our schools. We are not teaching our students as to how to respect a woman and which are her various roles. It is not only her role is not only to cook and be at home. Her role invites something different also. So all these issues, I think, we have to consider together. And I am a justice, as Dr. Harish Shetty has rightly said, that why women still continue to remain in the abusive relationship, that is also an issue. And to that angle also, we have to throw light. We have to, as a judge or as a legal profession or as a policymaker, we have to consider that aspect also seriously. So it was a really very interactive and good session where a lot of learning was there. And I find it was, from my point also, at least it was a very interesting and exciting exchange of ideas. Over to
Thank you, ma'am. We will again unmute Ratna ma'am, then we will ask Dr. Shetty to give the insights, because what has been come down during this says is audible. Dr. Shetty?
Yes.
Okay, you said, I thought that you were saying that it's not audible. Sometimes the headphones does create that feeling that one is not audible, because one touches the headphones, that gives the feeling. As the discussion, what has been dealt during all this round is around 1 hour, 45 minutes. One doesn't realize how the time has actually flown. But yes, that there are legislations, there were legislations, and legislations are coming in tune with the time, but they always say that it's very, very difficult, actually, the legislation to catch up, because what you catch up, as the time has paced up so fast, so the legislation also sometimes are not able to meet. And as we have two judges amongst us, amongst the panel, there are judgments which say that the court does not have the power to legislate. But again, the judgment of Vishakha and the Aravali judgment says you can't legislate. But Vishakha is a judgment where guidelines are laid down and ultimately culminates into an act of 2030. I will ask Dr. Shetty now. He is on a platform where it's a rare platform where we have judges, we have academicians, we have a psychiatrist who is well known in his own way. So again, before formal vote of thanks, I will again just thank Professor Shashikala, who has been able to bring all those people on a common platform to discuss an issue which is not only relevant during the COVID-19, but beyond. Dr. Shetty, what are your insights? We have heard you, but eventually you have also heard before and after. You were the, like we say in the scales of justice, the centrifugal point. You have heard from both sides before and after during the session. What is your take now?
There are more here who have had experience across sectors. I would like to ask them one question in short, if they could enlighten me, and that is out of the years of experience in academics, all of them are academicians also, and in your experience in teaching academics and experience of life, what is that one thing which we need to implement to accelerate the process of reasonable gender neutrality, reasonable empowerment of women? That's one most important thing. Anybody can start.
Dr. Shetty, I would say not anybody. We will
one,
ask
one.
then Professor Shashikala would choose that who will answer that.
No, it's okay. Everybody is free to.
No, I'm saying everybody. It's a free
session. What is the one thing? What is the one thing that needs to change, or what we need to do?
One intervention which can accelerate the process of bridging the gap between martyrdom to empowerment.
Change of mindset.
One intervention, change of mindset.
According to me, it should be the upbringing, the way we bring our issues, I mean, children. So home environment and children, you know, learn by observing, by imitating. So we have to improve our own conduct, and we have to improve their upbringing.
Well, according to me, can you hear me?
Yeah, ma'am, it's fine. Yeah.
According to me, Dr. Shetty, I think it's a matter of choice. The right to make a choice. I think that is the one which, according to me, would be the differentiator. The right to choose.
Professor Ratna. Ma'am, you will have to unmute yourself time and again. I'm just trying that.
You'll have to go to your screen and at the bottom, you'll have to click on the, done.
No, I would just support all of those, you know, which gives me three answers.
That's a rich.
I feel that children are the most important area where intervention has to happen. What they see in the school, what they see in the family. These are the places where the mindsets, as ma'am said, can happen. But that it's very difficult because the schools are also ruled by patriarchal segment. And that, I think, is the biggest challenge.
So what I feel is if masculinity can be equated with rahm, which is affection. I mean, if you are, if we start respecting a man who is... if the very value of masculinity and femininity are inclusive of both, we used to call Ardhanarishwar concept. But the Ishwar need not be on the right always. Ishwar can be on the left and Nari could be on the right. I mean, that's my interpretation of novel Ardhanarishwar. So androgynous kind of self-concept, you know, where the best of both the biological determinism could be neutralized and can be shown as complementary. And removing the value attributed to aggression. If communication and man-woman relationship or a homosexual relationship, any relationship in intimate partners is valued by the softness that they share than the aggression. I mean, what is civilization for? Civilization is a movement forward from savagery to refinement. I mean, we don't seem to see that. Even in a mode of punishment, when we do away with the death punishment, it is seen as highest civilizational protection of rights because we have, I mean, as Foucault says, we are averse to that public expression of violence, you know. So when a society moves forward, when civilization moves forward, it will attribute negative value to violence. Unfortunately, we seem to harbor the very value to violence in all our popular representations. Unless we teach that kind of critical literacy, I feel that critical thinking is also very important. I also saw that the litigation strategies by lawyers, for example. I mean, I was referred a case in a community legal care of a girl who had brought money from her parents' home and enabled the husband to purchase a property. And then when the property was sold, there was no communication to the girl was done, and then her husband disappeared from Pune itself. So litigation strategy was, I differ with Dr. Shetty that no lawyer simply gives a free advice because that's a strategy. So the lawyer said, you file a case under domestic violence, although they never had any episode of any form of violence. She had to help the lawyer to formulate the document. Then she withdrew the case. She said, I've lost the money. It's okay, I don't want to fight the case. Again, you call this martyrdom, or you call it as giving up, or somebody who is depressed. Psychological interpretation is one. choice, as Madam said, the choice by the person to make good the loss is another, litigation strategy is another. So all three are moving in different direction. So do we put the person with the rights in center, and do we focus that person, and do we follow the choices that that person has? And the ultimate question when it comes to choice, is it her choice? Is it her choice? Is she in the right frame of mind to make those choices? I would again cite what Catherine McKinnon said to Carol Gilligan. When his foot is on her throat, are her words, you know? So this kind of dilemma always exists in situations. So the very idea of choice needs to be viewed critically. That's my submission.
If I can just add from where Professor Gurpur and before that, Justice Joshi, you know, I read today morning, in fact, some very recent statistics data that out of 12,000 children who were taken on for some kind of a study, 5.96% were found to have been sexually assaulted. And out of that segment again, 54.4% were male children who had been sexually assaulted. And out of that, 37.82% were of the 15 to 18 age bracket, and 36.53% were from the 5 to 12 years age bracket. So, you know, as Justice Joshi said, that, you know, it's really sometimes not only about women and men or girl child and boy. It's about the generic, the enveloping evils of violence, and that can kind of, you know, affect any gender. It's actually, it becomes gender neutral at one point of time.
Ma'am, the point well taken. And once you have sometimes one panelist, like we had on one of the sessions, Justice Moshmi Bhattacharya giving insights, nothing stops, and then on injunction. And that session went on, and today we have five panelists, everyone in its own sphere, having its immense knowledge. So the time, as they say, time is like a ticking bomb, it continues to tick on. And sometimes, despite the fact that your heart doesn't agree that the session should be brought to an end, but as they say that all good things have to come to an end, but fortuitously enough, and the persons who are participating as well as the panelists, tomorrow we have another move forward with Symbiosis Law School, Spoon itself, with again Professor Shashikala Gurpur putting the ball into the motion in the right perspective with these sessions itself. Tomorrow we will be having a session on mental health law and disability law. Again, amongst us would be the two panelists, Professor Shashikala Gurpur and Dr. Harish Shetty would be joining along with Samindra Satwant and Advocate Vishwesh. But the question is that once the knowledge cycle, they say it's just like in a snowball motion, that once you start breaking off, the snowball continues to move. And once the thought process is of a good action, it is very difficult to control, but thankfully we have that control of the button where we can at least end, and we have to move forward. We have certain inputs which everyone will have within their minds, and as they say that it's just the triggering point, and sometimes the healthy discussions do help us to legislate the law, help us to move forward, help us to think in a right perspective. I could have done the vote of thanks, but I still feel that the entire platform, etc., was only because of Professor Shashikala Gurpur. It would be unfair on my part. I have said vote of thanks, so BAM is saying no, but I feel that the entire honor belongs to her. So it would be, I will ask her, since it's a collaborative action on our part to proceed in the right perspective, a short wrap-up note of thanks on behalf of Beyond Law CLC and Symbiosis Law Schools. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Vikas. I should thank you for giving us the platform and tolerating my, what you call as, I was being very directional in talking to you. You call them, you follow this one. We teachers do that all the time, you know. So thank you for tolerating that, first of all. And secondly, for us, it is the mission, this kind of outreach as a law school, Taking that initiative as a young lawyer and bringing so many people together, you have played a key role. Thank you for that on behalf of all of us at Symbiosis Law School, Pune, and the Faculty of Law at the International University. I thank our esteemed panelists and also Justice Moshmi for joining us, although you came to know about it and then you volunteered to come and you enriched our discussion. Each one of you, Dr. Shetty, you gave a new insight, and I'm sure that it would have answered all the gaps that we have in law in a different humanistic way with the caring profession that you represent. Dr. Joshi, for mooting the discussion in a very, very informative, well-researched initial note. Professor Ratna Kapoor, for those very sharp and very progressive, very all-encompassing remarks which come from your rich experience in the law reform in this country, bringing the global futuristic angles to the law. I have some of the senior colleagues there among the audience, especially Professor Lakshmi Jambolkar, one of the renowned names in international law, senior teachers of the country. Many other senior teachers I can see, Srinivasulu, I can see there vaguely. And all my dear colleagues from SLS who have joined here, Dr. Singh, Professor Manika, rest of you, the students, the fraternity, legal fraternity from all over the country, the young people who have been giving the burning questions. So I said, when I was trying to respond to what Justice Bhattacharya said, that we put vulnerability in the center, because vulnerability is the susceptibility to harm or pain or suffering. So tomorrow's discussion is on another form of vulnerability, which is mental health, and the other case which is connected and disjunct as well, the case of disability. Then the third in the series we are planning next week on children. So this is how we want to focus on vulnerability as an issue, because the vulnerable seem to be forgotten somewhere when we are more interested in making this country becoming the Security Council member or becoming one of the leading countries in terms of GDP against all the challenges that we are facing. We have forgotten the vulnerable. So I thought that this is one way of motivating our legal fraternity, because in any country when the revolution happened, the thought came from the legal fraternity. They wrote the constitution, they wrote the philosophy for the constitution. So I always say we have to reinvent for the vulnerable, who are comprising of almost 80% of our population. So let's hail our cause tomorrow with the new block of the vulnerable in the focus of our discussion, and happy Yoga Day for all of you. I reiterate on behalf of one of the audiences who had also raised a very sensible question. The last sentence I would like to say is that somebody said financial independence is not just having a job, but controlling the monetary aspect. Wonderful insight. And there are a few others who have talked about the underpinnings of patriarchy in the cases. Yes, lawyers and judges and the witnesses are no exception to it. So also the counselors in family court sometimes represent that. We had raised the grievance once to Bombay High Court. So with that, I thank all of you for a wonderful participation, audience. We are indebted to you in enriching this discussion.
Thank you, ma'am. Though I'd ask you to propose the final vote of thanks. But as they say that for a lawyer, it says it's a brief, but sometimes it runs into 100 pages. So even though once I said that you will propose the vote of thanks, but while you said three things just came into my mind. Like you said that you played the, I will say that during this lockdown, you played the key role to unlock the minds of the best of the brains of not only of India and Pan India. Number two, bringing of yours on the panel, these panelists and the persons who are participating of immense knowledge shows that you have that magnetic charisma to draw everything. Magnet only draws the iron, but you are drawing the best of the brains towards your platform. That shows volume, the way you can attract the people. And number three, you said that as a teacher, you were guiding me that you should do like this and the panel should move ahead. I am lucky enough that Eklavya had to have training through I tell my staff that it's through a correspondence course. But to have a guidance from a teacher of stature like you, I'm saying I'm blessed, like more like Arjun and Eklavya, to be guided where to move forward during these testing times. Thank you, everyone. Stay safe, stay blessed. Tomorrow, 5 p.m., we will connect everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Thank